It is, as always, such a blessing to have this time to be with you. I have a handful of announcements I want to just run through briefly this morning. For those of you at home, you'll notice that our video is a little off. We apologize again. We're having recurrent issues with our system that we're trying to get resolved, but this morning it was unsuccessful. So you're watching, but I know it's not the best scenario. For everyone, some other updates. Hopefully most of you have seen by now the updates that came out of our COVID task team. If not, there's a summary of some of those that came out of our, that are printed in your order of worship. They're in the most recent newsletter, the June newsletter that's gone out. Most of it is pretty straightforward, following what we're seeing in a lot of places, which is particularly with masks. Under our vaccinated individuals, it's completely up to you what you choose to do in masks. Those who are not yet vaccinated, we do ask that you continue to mask for your well-being and others. But outside of that, there's a lot of different details. The staff will continue to mask before and after the indoor services, as will our hosts. Just for those who are coming in with masks, we want to make sure they're as comfortable as possible, so we'll match that for you. But for the rest, those policies stand in that way. There's other things in there, but the biggest outside of that to share with everyone is to let you know that our Sunday fellowship time is soon to return. And we're really looking forward to that. 2 weeks from today, on June 13th, we're going to kick that back off. And that's going to take a new form, because our summer schedule is going to be a little different. This is the key for everyone at home and here. This service will not change. 9 a.m. will happen, as it's been happening online and here in the building, followed by fellowship time. The late service will move to 10:30. That will continue to be outside during the summer. And so we encourage those folks to come early so that we can all fellowship together between the two services. And that fellowship time generally, weather permitting, is going to take place outside. If the weather doesn't allow, we'll move it downstairs to Fellowship Hall. So next week will stay as normal. Don't get confused yet. But starting the 13th, our summer schedule will kick in. 9 a.m. online and indoors, followed by fellowship. 10:30 outdoors, weather permitting. So please just take note of that. The summer worship series will start at that time as well. Our summer of Sabbath and song. Part of that series is a handful of hymn sing days. If you have particular hymns you'd like for us to share this summer, please contact me. Let me know what those hymns might be, and then Rick and Julie and I will work together in framing those Sundays. If there's a particular Sunday you'll see in your order of worship, there's three Sundays where those hymn sings are taking place. If you have a hymn you want to do, but you can't be there on one of those Sundays, let us know. That way we can make sure we schedule it for one of the ones you can be here. But please, let us know if you have a few different songs you'd like to sing this summer. We'll certainly include them. Other things that are going on, the Youth Connect Mini Golf event is coming up next Sunday afternoon from 3 to 4:30. That's for our high school kids. There's notes in the order of worship about that. Repairs of the breach is next Sunday. So that link will go out on Tuesday. The office is closed tomorrow, so our weekly email will go out Tuesday morning. It'll have the link for all of this week's meetings, as well as the repairs of the breach sign up. And then those lunches will get dropped here next Sunday during our worship hours from 8 to noon in the north entrance. There's more in your order of worship. Any of you just got the recent newsletter? If not, you should soon, and that will happen even more. But as we turn our hearts to worship, I want to invite you, if you will, Rick, is for our prelude today. We're going to take a chance, an opportunity to sing together the Navy hymn. That's number 245 in your hymnals. It's not printed in the order of worship, because this is kind of a last minute thing. So number 245, the Navy hymn, will remain seated, but let's, those who wish to join along, please feel free to sing with us. psalmist brings us before God is, he writes, "Bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord, my God, you are very great. You are clothed with honor and majesty, wrapped in light as with a garment. You stretch out the heavens like a tent. You set the beams of your chambers on the waters. You make the clouds your chariot. You ride on the wings of the wind. You make the winds your messengers. Fire and flame your ministers. When you send forth your spirit, they are created. And you renew the face of the ground. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in his works. Who looks on the earth and it trembles, it touches the mountains and they smoke? I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have being. May my meditation be pleasing to him, for I rejoice in the Lord." Those who wish, I want to invite you to stand and let's join our voices again, this time in singing hymn number 298, God of Our Fathers.
To come into your presence
thanksgiving and praise, and to be refreshed by your Spirit, as we're drawn into the wonders of your presence. So hear us, God, this morning as we lift our hearts, our voices, our songs in thanksgiving. Through the winds of your Spirit, through the wisdom of your word, speak to our lives, that we may see more clearly the love, the grace, the light, the path you've shown to us in Christ Jesus, in whose name we share that prayer he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. The 8th chapter of his letter to the church in Rome, Paul reminds us that all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs. Heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if in fact we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified.
Thank you. go to John's Gospel, where Jesus speaks of being born of the Spirit. Listen for God's word. Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews, and he came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God." Jesus answered him, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above." Nicodemus said to him, "How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born?" And Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." Nicodemus said to him, "How can these things be?" And Jesus answered him, "Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." May we be blessed with understanding in this reading. Now, some years ago, I planned a children's sermon that would try to explain how God's Spirit in our lives is sort of like the wind. You can't see it, but you can feel it. And I had this. I had set up a fan where we were sitting, or on the steps in the chancel. And I had an extension cord plugged into the wall in order to reach across to the middle of the chancel. But the plug, like this, and the extension cord, did not actually meet as yet. I had it behind my back as we sat there, and I intended to make a concluding point for the kids with something along the lines of, to feel God's Spirit like a wind, we need to be connected to God, to Jesus. And my plan was to have the fan sitting there during this part of the talk and not doing anything, like it isn't doing anything now. And then go on saying, one way that we connect with Jesus is when we pray. And then I would plug the fan in when we did a prayer together, and voila, we would feel God's Spirit on us like a wind. Well, the best laid plans, as I began the children's sermon, a member of the choir noticed that the plug was not plugged in. And she, as I was beginning, she said, "Oh, wait, Julie, your fan is unplugged," and helpfully stood to plug it in for me. So my plan element of surprise wasn't much of a surprise as I fumbled through the rest of the way. Now, last week, Marty noted being struck by the question at the end of the reading from the book of Acts chapter 2, in which those gathered were perplexed by the surrounding diversity of people and languages being spoken. Yet somehow they understood each other and were asking, what does this mean? We are intrigued, aren't we? Drawn in by surprises or questions and possibilities, perhaps more than by answers. And over this past year or so, I've had a strong sense that God is and has been working through the stress and the upheaval, through the ambiguity and diversity of questions that arose surrounding how we were to respond to the variety of issues of the day. And even through the confusion that we all felt, God was in it. Yet, so many of these things inspire emotions and situations that we find uncomfortable. We are answer people. We are planner people. We are capable people. And we want to see the path in front of us. In fact, we want to be the ones to create the path, the ones who define the edges and the signs and the markers to delineate the twists and turns of the path we will follow. Because if we aren't making things happen, we feel we aren't accomplishing anything. Now, we might like to be entertained by things like a good murder mystery book or a series we can watch on the screens that we relax in front of. But we don't really like to live in and with mystery. And yet, mystery is the home of God's Spirit. And like the people's question about the coming of the Spirit at Pentecost, today Jesus speaks of the Spirit saying, the wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. In hearing this, we might feel in good company with Nicodemus' question, how can these things be? Nicodemus does not understand Jesus, responding first to what Jesus says with a literal rather than a spiritual understanding that Jesus offers. Nicodemus, who sought out Jesus, albeit in the dark, seeking answers, seems to find more questions. And yet, like Nicodemus did that night, we can open ourselves up to Jesus, trusting that this is where we can learn of God. Trusting in that connection of the Spirit that is God. When we come to Scripture, like we come to other ideas or conversations we hear, we begin from what we already know. But we can also see that we have an opportunity right in front of us and going ahead of us to be open to beyond what we already know. But it can be uncomfortable to do this. For I believe, as I said earlier, we are generally the answer people, the planner people, the capable people. And we like to believe make things happen, in order to feel that we're accomplishing something. And in many ways, we are privileged to be able to do so. It's humbling to let go of this identity of accomplishment and end results that we are the makers of. But in terms of hope, in terms of possibilities, in terms of what God is and will grow in us, we may have more questions than answers. You see, I believe that we are in a special, precious time of opportunity to move with the wind or spirit of God, to be moved as God chooses. And perhaps we are in that special, precious time in which God is accomplishing something as yet mysterious to us. And perhaps that is exactly where we should be. This week, the worship visioning team that has been gathering for a while met with a defined purpose: to trust the process rather than the need for results. And the time together began with this idea that we don't need to know what's going to happen. We don't need to know yet what steps should be taken to reach results, but to take what thoughts and insights that we have and to simply put all of them on the table. And I believe we all found it a good and empowering process so far. Jesus' answer, "For God so loved the world," to Nicodemus' question, "How can these things be?" has given us statements for banners and billboards and fodder for conclusions that have, for some, strengthened their faith, and for some, drawn lines in the sand over how to believe. And it seems more and more lately we encounter a phrase that is heard sometimes as a disclaimer of faith for those who are less or completely disconnected from the church, which says, "I am spiritual, but not religious." But rather than fearing this way of thinking as a bell tolling the decline of the church, perhaps we of the church need to embrace something about the "I am spiritual, but not religious." In a recent book, the Tuesday Book Group read, Richard Rohr wrote, "All spirituality is merely the imitation of God, as Ephesians says." While this may sound a bit ambiguous at its core, we know that this is what children do as they begin to grow. They imitate their parents. And as Paul wrote and Marty read, "For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God." And I have been reading the recently completed doctoral dissertation of a good friend from seminary. And as God so often does, I encountered things in it that I had already been pondering for today. And she wrote, "Spirituality is life in step with God. How members of a congregation, individually and corporately, live their faith will affect how they live into mission and ministry. Theology and spirituality are interwoven. Theology is the study of God, and spirituality makes that knowledge come alive. The wind blows where it chooses, and may we come days, in our hearts, in our community. How and what is the Spirit growing in us, in this church? I remember reading that the English word believe is derived from the German word for love, and to believe is to treasure, to hold something beloved. We do not have to have all the answers. We do not need to know what's going to happen in order to treasure God, to treasure each other, to hold God beloved, to hold each other beloved, and to trust that God holds us as beloveds. Let us be led by the Spirit and not fall into fear. There's a tremendous amount of freedom in this letting go of our sense of power and moving in and with God's. And I have some favorite pictures and quotes and prayers pinned to the bulletin board above my desk in the office. And one of the prayers is by Thomas Merton, and you have probably heard me read it before. Today I offer it to you again as it intersects with this thinking. But I'm taking liberty to change the I into we and the me into us as I do. It reads, "My Lord God, we have no idea where we are going. We do not see the road ahead of us. We cannot know for certain where it will end, nor do we really know ourselves. And the fact that we think we are following your will does not mean that we are actually doing so. But we believe that the desire to please you does in fact please you. And we hope we have that desire in all that we are doing. We hope that we will never do anything apart from that desire. And we know that if we do this, you will lead us by the right road, though we may not know anything about it. There we will trust you always, though. Though we may seem to be lost and in the shadow of death, we will not fear, for you are ever with us. And you will never leave us to face our perils alone. The Spirit of God blows where it chooses. Let us trust in it to lead us out of today and into tomorrow. Amen." And let us stand, if you wish, and sing together "Spirit of the Living God," number 226.
Spirit of the Living God, number 226.
offering our prayers before God, first, we together acknowledge what Memorial Day stands for. The many who served this country and gave their lives for our country, for us. To say we are thankful for their service and sacrifice does not meet with the strength of feeling we share acknowledging this. And so our prayers go out to the many who recently and long ago lost loved ones who served and died. We are grateful both to pray and sing our praise and our hope for the safety of those who are serving now. And we pray that there will be a day when peace is the way. I do have a couple of prayer requests to share. Donna Ritke asks for prayers for her cousin. We prayed for her recently, Donna's cousin, and now she is approaching another surgery on her lungs that will occur on June 2nd. And so Donna asks for prayers for her cousin, and we pray for the family that surrounds. And then Kurt Duke sent us a prayer request for Laura and Doug Lenny. Doug's mother, Molly Lenny, is currently going through chemotherapy. And so we hold them all, Molly and family, in our prayers during this time. Are there other thoughts, joys, or prayers that you would like to add? Let's be in prayer. Lord, we seek your Spirit to give us hope, to cover us in comfort, and to inspire us in your purpose. Our hearts acknowledge all of those who have served our country, who have lost their lives in this service. We give thanks that they are enfolded in your heart. For those who remain, who live in and continue living in the loss of a beloved here with them, those who have served in the services, but also those that have in these recent years lost loved ones while we were in time less able to gather around. Lord, we seek your continuing peace and way in their hearts and in ours. For the willingness to open our hearts and minds to the movement of your Spirit, Lord, we ask that this may be so, that you may aid us in cracking open that which should be recreated and renewed. We give you thanks for a beautiful day. Keep us mindful of those that are not with us, for safe travels, for whatever's going on, that they may be well. And we seek your continuing presence in Jesus' name. Amen. And now, let's sing together again. You may choose to stand if you wish. Number 301, America Beautiful. through the rest of your day. Amen.